So look at your neighbor and tell them it's time for you to soar. It's time. God's just trying to push you. So the pressure that you're feeling might not necessarily be the enemy. It could be God's hand.
That's right.
Pushing you to the next level.
Yeah.
Pushing you past the glass ceiling. Pushing you to the next level. Into the next dimension. And while you're still sitting down on your blessed assurance, God said, I need to push you forward. I got to push you to your destiny. I got to push you into your assignment. As long as you keep being lazy and comfortable, God says, I got to bring some discomfort. And the only way I can do it is put an enemy in your path.
Yes, yes. Now, God got it. Yes. Oh, Jesus.
So it's like the Queen of Sheba when she it said that when she came to test the wisdom of Solomon, she came to test Solomon's wisdom. You understand? Against the wisdom of those other ones that she knew in the world, including herself. And so she had to come and travel all the way from Ethiopia to come to Israel just to see and to test the wisdom of Solomon. She wasn't there necessarily to say, I'm better than you, or you ain't really got it. She came to see of the astonishment of what he really had. And so God sometimes puts you on the flat platform just for you to be able to know what you got. Watch this. And it's the kind of testing that he's referring to, where Abraham's faith was tested when he told him to sacrifice his only son Isaac on the altar there at Mount Moriah. He had to test him so that Abraham could see whether he had enough fear of God, whether he loved God more than he loved his son, whether he loved the blessor more than the blessing. And so sometimes God strips us of the blessings to see if we're going to love him more than whatever he gave us. So what he'll do is he'll put something in your hand. He'll give you a new job. He'll give you a new business. And then he's going to say, go ahead and give me a first fruit. Go ahead and give me some tithes off of that. And so he tests you with a little bit more just to see if you're going to love him more than what he put into your hand.
That's it.
Sometimes we can't handle the seasons of blessings because we fail to realize that it was God who gave us the blessing from the start. And so we don't honor him. We discredit him when it's time for us to sow the adequate seed and the resources that he availed to us. Oh boy, y'all got quiet when I start talking about money. But if truth be told, Jesus didn't talk about any other God but the God of mammon. When he was, read your good gospels. There's four of them, and if you read the gospels, you'll see that Jesus didn't talk about Islam, he didn't talk about Hinduism, he didn't talk about none of them other gods, but he did mention the God of mammon, which is money, because he know money can control you. And that's why he already put in the kingdom already a principle of tithing and sowing and giving of offerings and of alms. And so, because why? Because it shows us that where your treasure is, that's where your heart gonna be also.
Amen.
Money, 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 money.
Go ahead now. Go ahead.
And the reason why the glory can't fall sometimes is because we got too much heaviness in our pockets. We don't release the resources that God needs in order to what? In order to be able to bring glory in the house.
Go ahead.
Your wallet got more glory than the church has.
Jesus.
Oh, Jesus. Y'all looking at me. Well, it's dangerous now. It's getting dangerous. Let me wipe some of the sweat off. You're going to be tested with disappointments. People and systems are going to let you down. All right. You're going to be tested with disappointments. You're going to be tested with seductions, which seek to lure you away from the right way.
Uh-huh.
Okay, there's gonna be some stuff out there that's gonna try, you know, try to bring, get you up out of the wheel. You're gonna be tested with some dangers, some threatenings. Some stuff going. You're gonna be in threatenings, and to anybody ever been threatened to be put out your house and threatened to be fired off your job, and you felt like you was doing good, and before you know it, you don't have enough money or resources to stay in the particular house or whatever, and you got letters telling you you're going into foreclosure and all kinds of stuff like that. And so those are some dangers, and you know, it's a danger being black on the street. Truth, am I right? And if you get stopped, you don't know what's going to happen. It's just danger that's out here for us. I mean, and look at Libya. They're selling black folks. They're selling them into slavery. It's a lot of danger out here. And so we may be tested with dangers and tested with sacrifices. There are some stuff that we're going to have to give up, and we may lose some stuff. We may lose some money. We may fail in some businesses. We may lose some friendships and even some loved ones. But these things are never meant to make us fall, but to make us get up out of the mess and soar. They aren't meant to weaken us, but to make us stronger. They're not meant to make us bitter, but to make us better. They're not meant to crush us, but to grow us. And so you're going through the stuff that you're going through so that you can soar and become stronger and to become better and for you to become more mature in God. Look at somebody, tell them, count it all joy. So James said that the trying of your faith produces patience. And so James uses the Greek word here, hupomone, for patience, which means an unswerving steadfastness. God's trying to get us to a place where we're concrete, where we, you understand, where nothing can hinder our faith, where we'll stand tall in the beloved, where we know for surety and assurance that Jesus is coming back for a church without spot or wrinkle, and that we are included in that number. We know that Jesus is Lord. We know that there is no other name that is given among men under heaven whereby we must be saved. We know that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess. We know that there is only one Lord, one faith, one baptism. We know that it's Jesus. We know that it's for God I live and for God I die. So that come my way, though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. God's trying to get us to that place where we're not wavering anymore. We're not being tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine, every tale evangelist, everybody that comes in town, every prophet. You over here, you leaving church for 3 and 4 weeks, but the Sundays we can't even find you. But the next thing we know, you're at this conference, you're at this crusade, you're trying to get a word from this prophet, and God's trying to get you to stand still and be planted in his house so that you can grow.
Amen.
Unswerving steadfastness. So the trying of your faith produces an unwavering steadfastness. It's not just that you have the ability to bear and to put up and to tolerate with some stuff, but you had the ability to overpower it and to overthrow it and to overcome it by the blood of the Lamb. That's what God is trying to get us to, that point where we can be more than conquerors, where we can overcome and we can overpower and we can overwhelm the enemy. Now, how many want to give the enemy a headache? You want to?
Yes, yes.
That's what Jesus did. His heel bruised the head of the serpent. He gave the enemy a migraine. And you've got to say enough is enough in your household and in your life and in your mind. When you say, you know what, it's time for me to put the enemy under my feet. It's time to give the devil a migraine headache that he won't mess with me. He'll think twice before he comes my way, because I'm solid and unswerving in my faith. You have to count it all joy. We do this by counting it all
joy.
We can only become strong when we count it all joy. You mean, what are you saying? And every disappointment, every heartache, every danger, every seduction, every failure, every loss, every sacrifice, every time you go through pain and suffering and difficulties, you got to count it
all joy.
I thought we was in revival for a moment, but I feel like I'm missing you right now. See, let me say it one more time. Every time you have disappointments, and every time you have dangers and seductions and failures and loss and sacrifices, every time you go through hell, and every time you struggle, and every time you experience pain and suffering, you gotta count it.
All joy.
So what is he saying? He's saying you have to consider your trials as excitement from God.
Oh, Jesus.
Our God is an adventurous God.
Yes.
I don't know if you noticed, but he's adventurous. Uh-huh. He loves to have a lot of action and activity. And when God wants to show himself strong, when he wants to show himself powerful, he don't just use a little old circumstance.
That's right.
But he'll take us through darkness. He'll take us through some extreme difficulties. He'll cause us to almost lose our mind, and our hearts be crushed. Yes. And we're so broken, we don't know what to do with ourselves. And it's like David went through all kinds of stuff. And he when he was in Ziklag, y'all remember that? And all the whole camp was killed, and they snatched up the women and abused and raped them and did all kinds of stuff. And David was blaming himself, and he was crying, and he felt like giving up. He didn't know what to do. And until God spoke, and that's why Psalm 27, he began to say, except I see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Lord, give me one more time.
Yes, Jesus.
That's how Samson felt. He felt that when he was out there toiling and planning around, and you understand, he was testing God. He was going out there against God's word. God was still allowing him to be victorious because he gave him an assignment, and gifts and callings are without repentance. And so he kept on doing. He kept on snatching. Even with the jawbone of an ass, he was able to kill 1,000 Philistines, and he snatched the very gates of the Philistines, and he was doing all kinds of victorious stuff, and because he was being adventurous in God. But there was a time when he revealed his secret and found his eyes gouged out and found himself in a dark, horrible pit and churning and being a slave for his enemy. But he said, Lord, when he got tired, when he began to suffer long enough, when he couldn't take anymore, he said, Lord, if you'll just give me one more chance. Lord, if I could just... And all of a sudden, he got a sense that his hair began to grow back. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying? That's what the kind of God that we serve. God says, as soon as your hair grow back, I'm going to give you another opportunity. He set him up between two pillars when there were 10,000 of the Philistines out there dancing and partying and whoremongering and having a great time, an adventurous time. Here come God. He says, boy, I set you up. I know you've been suffering for a little time, for a little while. Look at your neighbor and tell him, but these light afflictions, but for a little while, and they're working for me a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. And just for a little while, God set